Thank you. dearest and most beloved Padawan.
And Lord of all, respected elders, dear brothers and sisters from all over the world, on behalf of the Canadian Pilgrimage Group and all those across Canada who could not be here today, we offer our humble pranams at your divine lotus feet. One might think its majestic and expensive landscape would make it difficult to establish meaningful and close connections between far-flung people in Canada. But only because of Swami's grace, devotees across Canada, filled with immense love, devotion, and determination, came together and worked incredibly hard as one Sai family, one nation, to present one unified cultural program with 235 Sai spiritual children. Bhagawan, we are so immensely grateful to you for giving us this divine opportunity to present a cultural program titled A Life of Sai Ideals at your divine lotus feet. This is a story about how a boy, Ravi, learning about the Olympics at school, dreams of participating in the Olympic Games, but believes it is impossible due to his physical disability. Seeing Ravi's sadness, his parents encourage and inspire Ravi by telling him six true stories from Canada that demonstrate Swami's teachings for living a life of full of Sai ideals. This scene is presented by the children from Ottawa. To demonstrate life is a song, sing it, children from Vancouver, British Columbia, and Edmonton, Alberta, present how much nature has to teach us in the life of the First Nations. In the story of the Underground Railroad, children from North and East Toronto present how slaves met great challenges through prayer and found freedom in Canada. In the story of Brother Andre, children from Montreal present a beautiful story of how a small and poor boy, through his selfless service and firm faith in God, was able to achieve his goal of building a large church in Montreal. To demonstrate life is a dream, realize it, the boys from South and West Toronto come together to present the story of Terry Fox, who achieved his dreams with his unwavering determination to bring awareness to those suffering from cancer. In the story of Walk for Values, Ravi discovers through a presentation of children from South and East Toronto that practicing human values is the cornerstone for a righteous and joyful life. In the last act, girls from Toronto offer a beautiful and graceful dance, expressing that our dear beloved Swami, God of our hearts, none of this opportunity could have been possible without your grace and love. You are the source of all love. Thank you, Saira.
Students, this is Jerome McGinley, captain of the Calgary Flames ice hockey team. He will be participating in the Vancouver 2010 Winter Olympics.
Hello, students. So, what do you know about the Olympics?
My dad took me to see the Olympic flame a few weeks ago.
Did you know that the flame comes all the way from Olympia?
Yes, and it travels across Canada too.
I saw it and it was cool.
I am really impressed with all of you.
The Olympic athlete made a big impression on little Revy, who rushed home after school.
Dad, guess what? We learned all about the Winter Olympics today.
What did you learn?
We learned that the Olympic flame comes all the way from Olympia in Greece. Dad, the rings on the Olympic flag made me think of the five human values that Swami teaches us. I really want to be an Olympic flag bearer for Canada when I grow up. But how can I become an athlete with an artificial leg?
Don't worry, Ravi. We will help you to realize your goals.
Come, children. Let us explain to you a few of Swami's ideals with examples. The first ideal is, life is a song. Sing it. The native people in Canada use songs and dance to remind themselves of the presence of God in everything.
The first sound that man heard on this planet came from the heartbeat of Mother Earth. If life is a song, we, the native Canadians, like to play it through our native drum. The elders teach us that living in harmony with nature is living with the Creator. We dance in a circle to the drumbeat of Mother Earth. The round form of the drum represents the universe, and its rhythm connects us to the beat of life. The drum is very sacred to us, and we use it in all our traditions. The basis of native lives is built around seven great laws of life. Each law teaches us a virtue that is embodied by an animal in the totem pole.
Turtle, truth. We believe the turtle embodies truth. The turtle's back supports Mother Earth like truth supports all the values.
Wolf, humility. Humility is what we learn from the wolf. The wolf bows its head to others, acknowledging a power higher than itself.
Beaver, wisdom. The beaver represents wisdom, using his sharp teeth to build dams for the family. Likewise, with our wisdom, we too should use our God-given skills for each other.
Bigfoot, honesty. There walks an honest man. This is the highest honor given to a person. Kitch Sabe was a giant who taught us about honesty and following the laws of the Creator.
bear, courage. The bear is gentle, yet very protective when needed. We too must show courage and protect our loving nature against harmful influences.
Buffalo, respect. The buffalo teaches us about sacrifice and respect by giving every part of his body for our survival.
Eagle, love. The eagle is the Creator's principal messenger of love. He teaches us that with the right vision, we can seek our life's true purpose.
This totem pole represents our seven great laws of life. With this understanding, we can complete the circle of life as one family. In peace and harmony, we can sing our way back to Mother Earth.
I think each animal represents a quality that we should all have.
Yes. And they are all divine qualities.
I want to fly like the eagle.
Swami says, first realize that nature has come from God. Only then God can be experienced. In the next ideal of life is a challenge, meet it, we will see the history of the slaves in the 18th century.
Go! Go! Start working! Field must be cleared by sundown, or everyone will be punished!
In the 19th century, forced labor was practiced in different parts of the world. The wealthy masters demanded hard work under the worst working conditions from these poor slaves. As a caring and compassionate Canadian, Dr. Alexander Milton Ross couldn't tolerate these inhumane practices and wanted to end them. He traveled under the guise of bird watching to the plantations where he helped these unfortunate people escape to Canada.
Good day. I'm Dr. Ross from Canada. I'm here to research on bird migration. May I please have your permission, sir?
Okay, go ahead.
How dare you stop working? Time is money, right? For this disobedience, you will not have supper tonight.
Is a challenge. Be ready to meet it. I'll show you how to escape to freedom.
Sir, I'm nervous to leave. If Master finds out, he'll whip me.
Yes, sir. I agree. We may be caught, and my family will be killed.
Do not give up hope. Have faith and confidence in yourself. Be ready to leave tonight, and do not forget my instructions.
I am ready to leave. This torture and harassment
is unbearable, sir. I believe in myself and in God. It is better to be free than die as a slave. See? God heard our prayers and has sent Dr. Ross to help us.
It is dark at night, and the slaves have gathered their strength and started the run. The journey was often seen treacherous to complete, despite the plan and secret routes. Many were caught on the way by the farm police and white men. Dr. Ross, along with the famous route guide, Harriet Tubman, are waiting for them at their first meeting point. Approximately over 100,000 slaves escaped to Canada via the Underground Railroad. Life is a challenge, and they did meet it.
Welcome. Welcome to the land of opportunities.
At last, we are here in Canada.
Brothers, your journey must have been so long. You look very tired. Come, come and rest.
Wait, brother. First, let us pray and give thanks to God for having met this challenge.
Their challenges were incredible.
Yes, but they faced them and finally achieved freedom.
Mom, I really felt sad for them.
They had prayed very hard, and only through the Lord's grace they were able to succeed. Swami's next ideal of life is a goal, achieve it, can be learned from Brother Andre's story.
See this young man? Instead of playing games with his friends, he prefers to pray. And if he is not praying, he is helping others. He has neither money nor physical strength, but his love for God is incredible. A few months ago, I sent a letter for his acceptance to the Brotherhood.
Father, Father, he has been accepted.
Good morning, Brother Andre. Still keeping things in order here at Notre Dame College?
Oh no, monsieur. Order and rule are for my superiors.
But, Brother Andre, you are becoming quite well known for your kindness to all.
If I can serve others, I do. I pray to Saint Joseph for his guidance. You know, when we surrender our mind to God, he takes care of us in every way. I also pray that our brotherhood one day builds a chapel for our holy patron, Saint Joseph.
Well, carry on, brother. Bonjour.
Oh, please, take me to Brother Andre.
Him? He is just a janitor.
Haven't you heard? This man performs miracles. Please, brother, cure me. I am suffering from intense pain in my knees.
Who? Me? I am nothing. It is only God who can heal you. Have faith, monsieur, and surrender your will to him.
I can walk!
This is a miracle!
It is surprising that I am frequently asked for cures, but rarely for humility or for the spirit of faith. Yet, they are so important.
Good morning, Your Grace.
Father, I understand your concern about the activities of Brother Andre. Please, clarify.
Yes, Monseigneur. Just a moment ago, I saw a crippled man healed. The brother prayed, and he was miraculously healed.
Is this God's work, Bishop Brucasey?
Well, does the brother ever claim to perform miracles?
Oh, no. He says God is the doer. We are only his instruments.
Would Brother Andre stop his activities if I told him to do so?
Absolutely, Monseigneur.
His only goal is to serve and to build a shrine for a holy Saint Joseph.
Then, leave him alone. If this work is from God, it will live. If not, it will crumble away.
If this work is from God, it will live. It will live. It will live.
Since its completion in 1967, St. Joseph's Oratory has become an abode of healing and of the renewal of faith.
Swami says, life without faith is a hopeless end. Life with faith is an endless hope.
Can we face all the challenges of life by having determination and a heart filled with love and devotion?
We surely can, Ravi. You will see the incredible story of Terry Fox in Swami's next ideal. Life is a dream. Realize it.
Hey guys, do you want to play a little basketball?
Sure, Terry. Let's go.
Ow! My knee! My knee!
Terry, what happened? Are you okay? Son, ever since the accident, you have had that pain in your knee. We need to have it checked by a doctor sooner than later.
By March 1977, the pain had intensified and Terry finally went to the hospital.
Mr. and Mrs. Fox, we have reviewed the images and the test results. Terry has osteosarcoma, a form of cancer that often starts near the knees.
To stop the spread of cancer, we have to amputate his leg 6 inches above the knee.
Doctor, does he need to remove half of his leg?
Please, is there any other treatment we can do?
I'm sorry.
Terry endured 16 months of chemotherapy. The time he spent in hospital was difficult as he watched fellow cancer patients suffer and die from the disease. Terry knew that with the help of an artificial leg, he would soon walk again. He became determined to help his friends with cancer get better.
Dad, this is the article that I read the night before my amputation. It is about Dick Trum, the first amputee who ran in the New York Marathon. Mom, Dad, I have a plan. I will also run a marathon. But I will run across Canada to raise awareness for the fight against cancer. In this way, we could do more research, find new medicine, and help those suffering from this disease.
Terry Fox ended his treatment with new purpose. He felt that he owed his survival to medical advances and wished to live his life, helping others find courage.
The running I can do, even if I have to crawl every last mile, I need your help. The people in cancer clinics all over the world need people who believe in miracles. I am not a dreamer, and I am not saying this will initiate any kind of definitive answer or cure to cancer, but I believe in miracles. I have to.
The marathon began on April 12th, 1980. Terry Fox was met with forceful winds, heavy rain, and a snowstorm in the first days of his run. Despite the sweltering heat of summer, he continued to run 26 miles per day. The physical demands of running a marathon took its toll on Terry's body. As a result, he was forced to give up his run after 143 days and 5,300 kilometers.
Everybody seems to have given up hope of trying. I haven't. It isn't easy, and it isn't supposed to be, but I'm accomplishing something. How many people give up a lot to do something good? I'm sure we would have found a cure for cancer 20 years ago if we had really tried.
Terry, you're my hero. I want to be just like you. Thanks, Terry.
He never expected the response he received and began to understand how people were deeply moved by his efforts. Terry had achieved his goal of raising awareness for continued research in finding a cure for cancer. Terry Fox returned to the hospital several times for treatments. However, the cancer continued to spread. He passed away on June 28, 1981, with his family at his side. The legacy continues in the name of the Terry Fox Run. Every year, the Terry Fox Run is held on September 13th in many countries all over the world. The 30th Terry Fox Run will be held in September 2010. Terry's life has raised the hopes of millions throughout the world to live with courage and determination. In this way, Terry's legacy lives on.